And optical remotensing rely on things that we all know that some objects reflect strongly the light, like the snow here, and some do not reflect strongly the light, like this typical soil here. So basically, everything relies on this property. And when we have a remote sensing image, what we have is that one image here, it is represented as a gray level image, it can be different. And this image is made of pixels. The pixel represents a certain amount of energy that is reflected, the energy of the solar light. So basically what we have here, in some places, we know that the sensor measures a high energy. And in other places, represented by another color, here black, the sensor measures a small energy. So it's all about measuring energy. I've shown snow and also this dark soil. So one reflects all the visible light. The other one reflects a very small amount of the visible light. But most of the objects are a little bit more complex in terms of what they reflect. Some objects reflect the light for one specific wavelength or a few specific wavelengths, and not so much for other wavelengths. We have two examples here, two types of grass. So some here reflects in the visible the light in the green. Here, this one, the light that is reflected belongs to the yellow symmetry wavelength. So optical remote sensing makes this distinction between the wavelengths. So if we have a white object, the sensor that is built upon a platform, the satellite, we measure energy over the same energy over all wavelengths. And if we have a green object, it will measure energy. By definition, the energy will be strong in the green. Below, it would be in the yellow. A gray will be a little bit of everything, and a black would be no energy in no wavelengths. So this is what is the basis of the remote sensing, of course, and it makes it differently for each pixel. So with our eyes, we can distinguish snow from soil because of the reflected light. We can also recognize grass from green grass. And optical remote sensing works exactly the same with one difference is that optical remote sensing uses, like our eyes, the visible light, the blue, the green, the red, but also it uses the light that we cannot see, the near infrared, the shortwave infrared, or middle infrared. So the instruments that we use are called multispectral radiometers. They measure the quantity, physical quantity, that is called the spectral radiance of the reflected light. And it makes that in several spectral bands. I will define later, probably not today, what is the spectral radiance. But now we can keep in mind that it is a quantity that is directly linked to the energy of the light. Well, I will develop that in the next lecture. And here in the table, you can see the name of the spectral bands of one specific sensor, Landsat. It's a Landsat 5 with a sensor called thematic mapper, so TM. So TM1, TM2, TM3, etc. Are the names of the spectral bands of this specific sensor. One belongs to the blue spectral domain. The TM2 belongs to the green spectral domain. And we have one band for a different part of the spectral, of the inside the visible domain and inside the infrared domain. each of these spectral bands are in fact precisely defined as a bandwidth, which are the limits in which the sensor measures the energy of the light that is coming. In fact, this is not a strict limit. It is more like beside this limit, there is a little bit of energy that is measured, but it is declining when we go apart, away from this limit. So about this table, it is specific to Landsat 5. If you use another sensor, the band number will be different. The band limits will be different. Some sensors will not have, for example, the green band. Some sensors will not have the thermal infrared band. So each sensor has got its own characteristic, and the order is not always, and the numbers are not always the same.
May I ask a question?
Yes.
The wavelength bandwidth, they don't, some are close and some are very, very different. And so does it mean that sometimes you have a kind of interference between the two bandwidths?
Which one, sorry?
The bandwidth wavelength, sometimes the maximum of one is very close to the minimum of the other, and sometimes it seems that they are very far apart.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
It means that sometimes you measure with error, and sometimes because you will catch blue and green together, it will be kind of mixed, and sometimes it will be the signal will be very different. What happens at the limit?
What the limit? So the limit are not so straight. It's like a part of the limit is maybe once there is one threshold, like it means that the wavelengths after the limit will contribute to less than 5% of the total energy that is measured. So it relies to the sensitivity of the detector inside the sensor. So it means a little bit probably of light in the blue domain contribute to the signal in the green spectral band. But this does not introduce errors by itself. But what it introduces is if you want to compare the measurement of one sensor, like Landsat, with the measurement of another sensor, like Spot HRG, for example, we have to keep in mind that the limits are not the same. So the measurements are not comparable one to the other from two different sensors. One reason why there is no measurement between, for example, the near infrared and the TM4 and TM5 is that the light is strongly absorbed by the atmosphere between these limits. So it doesn't reach the Earth's surface. So basically, it doesn't make sense to have a spectral band between these two limits if the objective is to study the Earth's surface. If the objective is to study the atmosphere, it is another story. But this sensor is designed to observe the Earth's surface. But directly to your question, there is no interference that comes from this reason, basically.
Thank you.
So, what does it mean to have a measurement in different spectral bands? It means when we download one Landsat image or any other multispectral radiometer image, when we download one image, in fact, we have several images, one for each spectral band. Here is you can recognize the city of Bordeaux here, and probably more easily is Arcachon, Massif. So these two images is in fact the same image here in the blue spectral band, here in the near infrared spectral band. So we have one different image for each spectrum. So this images are what are they made of? So first, they are made of pixels. Of course, their pixels are square. For each pixel, we have some coordinates. So for Landsat, the coordinates are given in a UTM reference system. Each pixel also have a value. And this value we can represent by a panel of colors here, for example, gray level, but we can do whatever we want with that. We can represent these values by any color scale. This digital number is directly linked to a quantity that is called spectral radiance, which is the power measured by per each unit surface in the solid angle of one steradian and for each unit of bandwidth. I will come back to this definition later. But the important point here is that spectral radiance is directly linked to the power that is measured, which means it is directly linked to the energy that is received by the sensor. And the relationship is quite simple. If you have the pixel digital number, you can directly derive this physical quantity, the spectral radiance, by applying a simple function with two parameters, A and B, that are provided with the image. I will come back to that later. So basically, we don't have a physical quantity in the image, but we have a number that is directly linked to this physical quantity. So it means also that measurements by spectral radiometers are quite different from photography. This is why we don't talk about remote sensing photography. We talk about remote sensing images because of one of the reasons is this property that we can derive a physical quantity that is perfectly characterized. So coming back to that, in this image, if you have a big number, it means you have a high spectral radiance. If you have a small number, it means you have a small spectral radiance for this pixel. So every kind of surface reflects very differently, absorbing and reflecting weakly or strongly in different wavelengths. So it means these different objects don't have the same property when we talk about how it reflects the light. And the way this is characterized is the spectral signature. Spectral signature, first of all, it's like a fingerprint of all these surfaces. Each surface type, like vegetation, snow, sand, water, concrete, macadam, they all differ in the way they reflect the light. And this is summarized as the spectral signature. The spectral signature give us something that is called the reflectance for each wavelength. These spectral signatures are established in laboratory or with a field spectral radiometer, and they are not established from remote sensing images. So it means that we don't get this spectral signature from the remote sensing images themselves. But we use this spectral signature as a source of information that serves as a reference to understand the images. So what is a reflectance? Reflectance is a fraction of the energy that is irradiating the surface that is then reflected by this surface. So the surface receives some energy, a fraction of it is reflected, and this is called reflectance. Is it? Can you hear me? Because I cannot plug a, microphone. Can you hear François?
Yes, we can hear you, but like it's we hear your ventilator basically.
Yeah, but I don't have a plug for a microphone, unfortunately.
Okay, then we have to proceed in this way.
Yeah, I'm sorry about that. So reflectance is a fraction of the energy that is reflected. So what we can see here is that to understand better what is spectral signature, we can have a look to what is snow, to the snow. So snow is a white object, which means it reflects a lot the light in the blue, green, and red part of the of the wavelengths corresponding to this three colors. So in this figure, we can see it here. The reflectance is close to 100% around 0.4 microns. Also for 0.6 micron and to close also close to 100% in close to 0.7 microns. So snow is reflects a lot of the light in these three specific wavelengths. So that's explained why the white light is reflected also altogether, and we perceive it as a white light. If we look still at the snow, we can see that this behavior is totally different in other wavelengths. For example, here, around 1.6 or 1.5 microns, we can see that the light is almost unreflected by the snow. So it means snow that we consider as a perfectly reflecting object is not a perfectly reflecting object. It is the case only in the visible domain. We will have a look also to vegetation. Vegetation is totally, it's a very typical, spectral signature I would develop on later. So, for vegetation, what we see in the spectral signature is that the light in the near infrared domain is quite strongly reflected, but in the visible domain, the light in the red channel, in the red wavelength, in the blue wavelength is almost unreflected, and it is a little bit more reflected in the green, in the wavelengths corresponding to the green. This explains why vegetation appears green. Most of vegetation appears green when we look at it. So now, this picture here is a photography. So it's not really interesting, but it's a special kind of photography. We can, of course, we can recognize the different objects here. And the way this picture have been made is that it is a special camera working in the near infrared domain. So it means everything we look here, all the vegetation with the photosynthetic parts appear very clear because of this spectral signature. It means that what we see in the spectral signature is that vegetation reflects the near infrared light much more than the different type of soil, sand, concrete, macadam. Also, it reflects the light much more than water. And if we had snow in this image, we don't have, but if we had, snow would appear even more white than vegetation. It's not the case. So it means everything that is around approximately white in this picture is a photosynthetic vegetation. We can even see on the roof some moss that cover it. So basically, and when we talk about vegetation, when the near infrared, red, green, and blue lights hit the leaves, almost what we are is that a green, some green is reflected, and a lot of near infrared is reflected. This is explained by the fact that in the leaves, when the tissues are young and healthy, there is a pigment, chlorophyll, that absorbs the light in the blue wavelengths and in the red wavelengths. So this energy that is absorbed by the chlorophyll in these two wavelengths is used for photosynthesis. And photosynthesis, of course, is consists of absorbing some carbon dioxide to produce glucose, for which the solar energy in these two wavelengths is necessary, and a byproduct is dioxide. If we look now, so this is basically this is explanation for this wavelengths from 0.4 microns to 0.7 microns. If we look further away, for larger wavelengths, what we see is that the near infrared is strongly reflected, what we cannot see with our eyes. This is because of internal tissue inside the inside each leaf that reflects. Because of the structure of some organs of the leaves, the near infrared is strongly reflected. So this is quite a typical behavior of vegetation, that when we have some object that does not reflect the red light, but strongly reflect the near infrared, we can conclude that we have some vegetation. So if we look now at this spectral signature at different phenological stages, when what I said is true only when the leaf is totally green, so when the leaf is young, but when the senescence starts, the spectral signature changes totally. And the reflectance in the near infrared drops, but very importantly, the reflectance in the red wavelengths increase because there is no absorption. There is no absorption because this leaf is not able to carry out photosynthesis anymore. And this is more. Yes?
So here you're showing like maple leaves, like broad leaves. Is it the same for needles? Because typically, pine trees may keep their needles all year round, but so do you see the same kind of difference?
No, you don't. I mean, if the needles are becoming when they are becoming yellow, when they are dry, for example, or ready to fall down, you will have the same differences. But it's not on the same pace, for example. So this is the spectral signature for this maple. Every species will have a slightly different. I mean, even deciduous broadly, they would differ a little bit. And needles will differ probably a bit more, but more approximately, it would be the same behavior. But at the scale of the At the scale of the landscape, you will not see it because it will not be homogeneous like this, like it can be with the broadleaves.
Okay, thanks.
Professor?
Yes.
In the case of say during autumn when there are no leaves, would it still catch vegetation or not?
No, you don't. If there is no leaves, you don't get at all the same spectral behavior. So if you are looking to a forest, still you can find some differences between the forest without leaves and the other type of surface. But it will not be as easy to interpret as in the case the leaves are present. So in the case you are looking to a forest during winter when there is no leaves, it could be interesting to have a look to the radar data, because it will be sensitive to the Linnaeus part of the vegetation. Optical remote sensing is not so sensitive.
Okay, thank you.
If you look to the deciduous forest in winter with very high spatial resolution remote sensing, you can see the different forms, the structure, and things like that of the typical of the forest. So you can recognize the forest with by photo interpretation, for example. But it does not. Rely on the same. The interpretation does not rely on the same on the same properties in this case.
Thank you.
So here is the image of the city of Le Caire in Egypt, in the red spectral band, in the near infrared spectral band. You can. Here is it was in 1985, and since then the city became much bigger. But here the city in this year is here. Around you have some desert, some sand. Here you can recognize the river, the Nile River, and all around there is agriculture. And what we can see in this example is that in order to find where is the vegetation in this image, you have to find the places for which the pixels, for which in the red image you have something quite dark but clear in the near infrared image. These two conditions is sufficient to conclude that we have vegetation, because in the red image there is absorption of the red light, so the red light is not so strongly reflected. And in the near infrared, the near infrared light is reflected. So, and in fact, this interpretation is basically everything that we do in optical remote sensing that consists of interpreting at least two spectral bands to know about what we are looking. Still about vegetation, the reflectance of leaves in the reflectance of leaves in larger wavelengths. Until now, we stopped approximately in this wavelength. When we reach the shortwave infrared, the reflectance drops, increase again, and drops again. And these drops, this one and this one, are due to the absorption by the water molecules, the absorption of the light by the water molecules. Which means that looking in this spectral band here allow to monitor water stress, vegetation water stress. So there are some methods that are based on characterizing how much is the difference between the reflectance in this spectral band and in this spectral band. Because if in case there is some water stress, it means there is less water. So the reflectance will be bigger in this wavelength and this wavelength. So another surface that we often find in the images is water. And water has got a moderate reflectance in the blue wavelength. And this reflectance become less and less strong when we go to higher wavelengths, for example, in the red, and there in the near infrared, and here the curve stops, but basically the reflectance in the shortwave infrared is equal to zero. So it means everything is absorbed. If we look to the water, so it's the same graph, but with another format, that explains the reason why the reflectance of water is small. So in the visible band, the reflectance of water is small because the light that arrives on water is transmitted, which means that if we have pure water, the visible light can go through the water body. This is obvious. If we are underwater, we can still see the light from the sun. And from a certain wavelength, approximately in the near infrared domain, the reason why I finished on this part, because the light is transmitted, it means it is not reflected. The light go to the bottom, continue in the same direction. And above 0.7 microns, approximately, the reason why the reflectance of the water is low is different. It is because the light is absorbed by the water molecules. So now I come back to this and I will make the same exercise as before when I interpret these two images together in order to say here is vegetation in another way, which is called color composite. So basically, all the interpretation of remote sensing images rely on something that is interpreting together several spectral bands. Here in this example, two spectral bands. So if we want to facilitate this interpretation, we can use the color composite procedure. Color composite consists of making the sum of, in terms of display, not in terms of a mathematical sum, but in terms of the display on the screen. So we make the sum of the three spectral bands, which are not shown in gray level, but in but with primary color. So basically, here, this image was produced using the blue spectral band, the green spectral band, the red spectral band. And on the screen, the blue spectral band is displayed with a blue primary color. The green is displayed with a green primary color. The red spectral band is displayed with a red primary color. So where, for the pixel for which the value in the blue spectral band is strong, and strong for the red, for the green spectral band, and for the red spectral band, it means we will bring a lot of blue, a lot of green, a lot of red. We will obtain some white, because a lot of blue plus a lot of green plus a lot of red goes to the white color. So basically, here for the cloud, this is what happened. And for pixels that are dark in each of this image, we will obtain a black color. But for intermediate cases, for example, in this case for vegetation, it means for the pixel which have got some weak value in the blue spectral band and in the red spectral band, but not so weak in the green spectral band, the green spectral band will be displayed in green. So the color that will dominate will be green. So this is very classical method to display the different spectral band. And in this case, because we have shown the blue spectral band with blue, the green spectral band in green, the red in red, we call it the true color composite. So true colors means what the blue is displaying blue, etc. Here is another example. So color composite, we have three spectral bands are shown in gray levels. Instead of gray level, we show it in respectively in red, green, and blue colors. And we make the sum of these three ones. We obtain one image that is very easy to interpret. It's quite easy to know where is the water, where is the vegetation, where is the beach. So now, we can also use, and we often do use this, a false color composite. So false color composite is anything different from this table. So we can do something that is not useful, like we have the red spectral band and we show it in blue, and the blue spectral band we show it in red. In red, there is no reason to do that, but this is a false color composite. But the interest of false color composite is to do that. If we have a blue spectral band, we can show it in blue. There is a primary color that is called blue. The green, we can show it in the primary color green. But by definition, there is no primary color that is called near infrared. So if we want to associate these two spectral bands, we have to choose one of them to show it in one of the primary color. The red. So in this case, the near infrared will be shown in red and it will be associated with the blue and green spectral. And when we interpret visually remote sensing images, we very often do this sort of things. And we obtain this type of images that I'm sure you may have. All of you, you may have already seen, in which the near infrared band is shown in red, and it is associated with the green and blue spectral band. And in this image, the vegetation appears in red, because for vegetation, the pixel value is strong in the near infrared. It is low in the green and blue spectral bands. So it means because it is high in the near infrared and because near infrared is displayed in red, on the screen, the red color will dominate. So this is probably the most typical, the most used color composite that is that exist, and it is very often used in this order. So other examples, like in Paris, you can all recognize the Seine River, the Boulogne and Vincennes. We have three spectral bands in green, in red, and in near infrared. If we associate these images together through a color composite, you will get this image in which finding where is the vegetation at the time of the acquisition is very easy. Everything that is red is vegetation in this image. You can find some very nice color composite in this case. It is one image across the border between USA and Mexico. The border is here. You have a city. I think it must be Calexico and Mexicali. And in this color composite, you can see very big difference in the status of vegetation. These differences are not due to climate, of course, because it is a part of the same border. It is due to access to water, that is very different with agricultural practices that differ a lot from on the two sides of the border. So color composite basically is a key technique, and it's a very easy technique, of course, when you need to visually interpret remote sensing images. So now we will, maybe you have a question until before I go to the next section.
Fine on my side, but I don't know if other people have questions. Yes, we can continue. Like,
okay. So now I will talk about differences existing between different spectroradiometer, between different optical remote sensing sensors. So I will talk about orbit, SWAS, and spatial resolution, and the links existing between all these different objects. So the very key variable when we use optical remote sensing, or remote sensing in general, in fact, is what is called the spatial resolution. You can see here the same object observed with different spatial resolution. Of course, spatial resolution affects very strongly what we can do with optical remote sensing and how we do it. So spatial resolution, its definition is not the size of the pixel. Size of the pixel and spatial resolution is two different variables, even though they are linked. The definition of spatial resolution is the size of the smallest object we can distinguish from a neighbor. And in terms of optical remote sensing, we can define some category of spatial resolution. These categories are not the same in the other types of remote sensing. So for optical remote sensing, very high spatial resolution means below 5 meters. High is between 5 meters and 30 meters. Medium resolution is between 100 meter and 1 kilometer, and low is above 1 kilometer. So we have these different distinction because optical remote sensing can be used for different purposes. It can be used to observe some very big object, like here, some climate-related objects, some storms or movement of clouds, or these sort of things, so for which we need low spatial resolution. It can be used also to detect man-made objects like boats or objects on the boat, for which we need very high spatial resolution. And all these types of remote sensing have got their own interest for the specific application they are designed for. If we look at low spatial resolution here, low spatial resolution is obtained essentially for modern remote sensing sensors, for satellites that are designed for meteorological observations, like Meteosat. This sort of satellite is very special compared to the others because it has got a very specific orbit. The satellite is positioned very far away from the Earth at 36,000 kilometers from the surface. And at this specific altitude, the satellite has got the property to go around the Earth exactly in 24 hours. Now, it means exactly at the same speed on which the Earth rotates on itself. In other words, the satellite can stay always above the same point, which allows to do that, which allows to see the big part of the Earth. This big part is quite big. It's about 120 degrees in latitude and longitude. So yeah, and it stays always above the same point. So here we can see the African continent during approximately at noon, on morning, or in evening. And in fact, because of this geostationary orbit, the surface can be seen every 15 minutes. So we have very frequent images. The spatial resolution, because the satellite is very far away, and probably not only, because we don't need for this application the very high spatial resolution, the spatial resolution is quite low, above 1 kilometer. For all the other optical sensors, we will have a near polar orbit. And it is also called sun-synchronous. Do you still see my screen? Zoom tells me that it's not active anymore.
We see your screen, but no, it's kind of no. We still see your screen actually. So we have the slide about near polar orbit and sun synchronous. So.
We don't hear you.
Yeah.
So the orbit is near polar. It means the satellite is not positioned above the equatorial plane as for geostationary satellites. But turning.
Nicolas, I don't know what you have changed, but the ventilator is making more noise now than before.
Oh, I'm sorry. I haven't changed anything. So the satellite is not staying above equator as in a geostationary satellite, but it's turning around the Earth, passing not far from the poles, not on the poles, not far from the poles. So when the satellite is turning, meanwhile, Earth is turning on the axis made by the pole. So it means that when the satellite is turning around the Earth is turning. So if we look at all the orbits of this specific spot satellite in one day, we have this trajectory. So this is what is the trajectory of the satellite for one day. When the satellite is here, it can make, wherever it is, it can make some measurement. And it can make measurement of the spectral radiance across what is called the swath, which is the size of the band of territory that is observed. So this, all the satellites that I'm going to show some images differ in terms of orbits and in terms of swaths, and it is a combination of the two, of these two factors that explain a lot of properties of the images. So I will go across a few images and then I will develop on the links between these different factors.
Professor?
Yes?
The near polar orbit satellite, it goes once around or like multiple times?
I couldn't hear you, sorry.
Does the satellite go once around the Earth or multiple times?
It goes around the Earth very often. It takes about 1 hour and a half to go around the Earth. So it means the satellite does that, and 1 hour later, or 1 hour and a half later, it will do this one. So every day, it will go around the Earth very often.
Okay, and hence it will take a larger picture. Okay.
So here is one image part of South America, and part of Brazil, and other countries like from a sensor called Spot Vegetation, which has got a spatial resolution of 1 kilometer. This image is made of the measurement or the observation of a satellite. It's made of different orbits, actually. Each orbit of this satellite makes a measurement of a few thousand kilometers, so a part of this area. And this specific image here is a synthesis of different orbits. But this image fully can be obtained in a few days. Time frame. Another region of the another part of the world with the sensor. Yes.
We're still in the near polar orbit figure. Actually, it doesn't move.
Can you see now?
Yes,
yes,
it changes. Yes.
Okay. So sorry about that. So in this image, what you can see is a part of South America, observed by a sensor called Vegetation, which is on board the Spot satellite. The Vegetation has got a spatial resolution of 1 kilometer, and it goes together with a very large swath. About 2,000 kilometers. So it means this image, in fact, is a synthesis of several images of this sensor, but all these images were acquired in less than 10 days. So this is what you can observe. In fact, it is what we can observe in 2 days. And when you move to 10 days, you can remove a lot of clouds, basically. I will come back to that later. But just keep in mind that with this medium spatial resolution goes to large swaths, so we can observe a big territory in only a few days. And this is the same, this image here in Siberia. In the same category of sensors, but with a slightly finer resolution. MERIS, it is a sensor that was on board the Envisat satellite that does not work anymore. So the footprint of this image was this size. So this is, contrarily to the Spot Vegetation before, this is the image that is observed in a few seconds, basically. So one image. In one image, you can cover a very big part of the territory, which corresponds to several states in Brazil. In the same category, you have the sensor MODIS. And here, in this sensor, you can see the Canary Island. And you can see some sand from the Sahara moving due to the winds. So here, you have a spatial resolution of 250 meters. We go still to finer spatial resolution. So if we look at the first generations of Landsat, this Landsat 1, Landsat 2, I think 3 and 3 also, was equipped with a sensor called MSS, of which spatial resolution was 80 meters. And from 1984, there is a sensor called Thematic Mapper, TM, equipped with resolution is 30 meters. This is from 1999. it's still 30 meters, but it has a spectral bandwidth, a special spectral band, called panchromatic, of which the spatial resolution is 50 meters. And the newest generation of Landsat still have the same spatial resolution. Here you have Aster, 50 meters. You can see some in Himalaya here, you can see some glacier. And when you have some images that are separated by a small time lag, a few months time lag, you can see the glacier moving. You can measure the speed of the displacement of the glacier. Spot 5, which is the old generation of Spot family satellite, the resolution was 10 meters. The newest generation of Spot 6 and 7, sorry, is 6 meters, and panchromatic is 1.5 meters. Here is Iconos. So Iconos has got a spatial resolution ranging from 0.8 meters for the panchromatic mode to 4 meters for the multispectral mode. So this image is 4 meter spatial resolution.
So Nicolas, maybe we'll discuss that later on, but here we clearly see the shadow of the Eiffel Tower. We could even think that there are two towers. So is it the case that if you go towards a sharper resolution, you get more of those problems, or is it like, is the shadow a problem that you have at all resolutions?
Especially at high resolution. Of course, if you have some object like the Eiffel Tower in a Landsat image, you will see it. But the impact is much much more strong at high resolution.
And does it mean that if you have, because I suppose that the angle of the sun is important, but the angle of the satellite is also important. Yes. And so can you use several images to recompose a 3D image, for instance, or am I going too far?
For 3D images, you can use several angle images, and this belongs to what is called photogrammetry, and it is based on a stereoscopic effect. So photogrammetry is a category totally apart within within remote sensing, and it does not use really the, in fact, it does not use the difference in shadow, but it uses the fact that when you look to an object with a difference in altitude from different angle, you will have some differences in the pixel position within the raw image. And if you interpret this position of the different pixels corresponding to the different object, you will be able to evaluate the altitude and the relative differences in altitude between the different pixels. And this rely on very high spatial resolution images, and that it relies a lot also of aerial photography. You can do it with photography. You don't especially need radiometer measurements for that. So it's quite different. Quite a different way to approach the problem.
Okay, thanks.
You have within what I showed between the different sensors that I showed, I talked about Aster just before, 15 meters spatial resolution. And there is a worldwide digital elevation model that is freely available, that is based on this sensor. And it is based on this sensor because this sensor is able to offer measurement or observation of the same surface from different angles. So this is The sensor prism on board the Japanese satellite ALOS also offers some possibility to have some digital elevation model. So these are a sort of medium or high resolution, but about 15 meters. And for what you say exactly, interpretation of this image, it relies on, of course, higher resolution. And there is no worldwide product available for that. It will be more case by case.
Okay.
Very much used for drone remote sensing nowadays also. So just to clarify a little bit what is the difference between panchromatic and multispectral, if we look at the Iconos image in these two modes, panchromatic, multispectral. So multispectral is what I said before. We have one spectral band for the red, for the near infrared, for the blue. Panchromatic, the definition of panchromatic is that there is no distinction between the blue wavelengths, the red wavelengths, the green wavelengths, and the near infrared wavelengths, for example. So it means we have one big spectral band instead of four small spectral bands. And the interest of doing so is that because the bandwidth is large, the number of photons that arrive to the sensor is big, and it is easier to measure a big quantity of photons precisely with a small error than a small quantity of photons. So basically, when you have a panchromatic mode, panchromatic image, you have a bigger energy to measure, so it's easier to distinguish one object from the other. And so in final, we say we have a better radiometric resolution in panchromatic. What is the consequence of having a better radiometric resolution is that it can be used to get a better, finer spatial resolution. So to continue, quick bird is quite similar to panchromatic, to Iconos. GOI also. And finally, Pléiade, which is a French sensor, is down and has got resolution down to 0.7. So in terms of the different sensors that I have just shown, there is something important to say is that all these very high spatial resolution images are not free. You need to buy. You need to buy them. Spot also, Spot 6 and 7, the images are not free. Aster, I'm not sure, but all above, like from Landsat to MODIS, to Spot Vegetation, Probavi, and all these sort of sensors, all images are freely available. You just need a user account to download them. So this makes quite a, this has got quite an importance when choosing the images. So how this is obtained, basically? It is very strongly linked to source. If we look to this satellite Spot, so again, the same satellite Spot 5, so here is Spot 5, and on Spot 5, you have a different instrument. And I don't show one of them, which is called HRS, but which is close to what you asked, François, for to get an idea of the altitude. So what I call the stereoscopic effect and photogrammetry. So there is a third instrument that I don't show in this picture, in this slide. So here on the left, what we see is that on this satellite, we have two sensors which are called HRG, High Resolution Generation. I'm not sure about the G. these sensors, they are twins, so exactly the same. And each of the sensors have got a 60 kilometer swath, which means the images that will be provided will be 60 kilometer by 16 kilometers also. And we can have two, or because the direction is adjustable, we can have one big image of 120 kilometers by 60 kilometers. These sensors are the sensors that have 10 meter resolution. On board the same satellite, you have spot vegetation, the sensor for which I showed Siberia and Brazil before. And this sensor have got a very large swath. So it means, very large means more than 2,000 kilometers. With a very large swath, it means because the satellite go more than 14 times around the Earth every day, it means the full planet, almost the full planet, can be observed every day. And here is one image, not from this sensor, but from MODIS, which is quite similar. And what we can see is that except over the tropics, where there are some unobserved part of the world, unobserved surface, all in high latitude, there is a full coverage, and even in the tropic, most of it is covered. So it means there is a full coverage of the Earth every 1 or 2 days. And this cannot be done with a high spatial resolution. It is done with a medium spatial resolution. So from 100 meters to 1 kilometer, in the case of spot of vegetation, it is 1 kilometer. This sort of images is always associated with high or very high spatial resolution. But of course, it means that if the user has chosen to observe this area, it means that this area is not observed at the same time. The satellite is moving in the direction of the red line here. So when it is above this point, the choice was made to observe this area. So we cannot see that. The consequence of that is that the time for reobservation depends on the duration that is needed for the satellite to pass over the same point. So in order to observe this, we need to wait that the satellite go above the same red trajectory than here. I will come back to that later, just to show again some differences between medium resolution and high resolution. And together with the difference in the swath, which totally pilot the size of the image. Here you can see one image of MODIS, 1,000 kilometer by 1,000 kilometer, and one image by Landsat, 180 kilometer. So of course, when you need a big synoptic view, you need MODIS. If we look to in details, the same area across the border between the two images, what you can see here is the effect of the lower spatial resolution. You can see very much that a lot more detail in the Landsat image. For example, you can see this river that you can hardly distinguish in the MODIS image. So now, just to finish today's lecture, I will explain the differences of the link between different properties like time for revisit, swath, which means coverage, or spatial resolution. So here I need to introduce two variables, which are the orbital period. And the orbital period is the duration in minutes of one orbit around the Earth. So typically, what you can keep in mind is that depending on the altitude, the satellite needs about 1 hour and a half to a little bit less or a little bit more to go to turn around the Earth and come and to turn around the Earth for a full orbit. During this time, the Earth turns on itself. So it means that when the satellite makes another orbit, it will not pass over the same places. And the orbital cycle is the time, is the duration in days that is necessary to come back over the same point. So it totally pilots the time for reobservation. So first, what we see in this figure and in this equation is that the orbital period, the time necessary to make one orbit, is only linked to the altitude, A. A is altitude. T is orbital period. And here what you see that the orbital period in minute is for a satellite at 800 kilometers, it's about 1 hour and 40 minutes. For a satellite that is 1,000 kilometers, it's a little bit more. And here, I give some examples. For the satellite Spot, the altitude is 120 kilometers, which mechanically means that the orbital period is about 101 minutes, which means every day the satellite will go around the Earth 14 times plus a small quantity. And because this small quantity, it will be necessary to have 26 days to come back exactly on the same trajectory, which means the orbital cycle will be 26 days. Let's take another example, Formosa 2. The altitude is much higher, 940 kilometers. At this altitude, the number of orbits every day is an integer number, a purely integer number, 14 orbits every day. Which means because it is an integer number, the next day it will come back exactly on the same trajectory. So we have a one-day cycle. This satellite will go around the same place every day. Another example, Venus.
Okay, Nicolas, it will go over the same place every day, but does it mean that it covers the whole world, or does it mean that you have some parts of the world which are left uncovered forever?
Yeah, this is it. This means, I come back in the next slide, but this means that most of the Earth's surface will be unseen by this satellite.
Okay.
So Venus, the cycle is 2 days. The altitude is 720 kilometers. At this altitude, we can calculate the period. And from the period, we can derive that the number of orbits every day is 14.5, so half. So it means, because it is 0.5, we have a two-day cycle. So every 2 days, the satellite will go around about the same place. So.
But is there an incentive to have a satellite which is very far? Because the closer they are, the more turns they do around the Earth, and so the more images you have. And on top of it, I suppose the closer you are to the Earth, the easier it is to have a high resolution, isn't it? It's a bit naive, huh? But...
Actually, it depends really on what you want to do with what the people who decide to pay to have a satellite want to do. So we depend on the satellite objectives. And here, basically, you can see. So first of all, it's not a good idea to have a very low altitude for a satellite, because it will be attracted by the Earth and it will fall down. So it's not good. So it needs to be higher for that. But there is a lot of possibility above, for example, 500 kilometers. Everything is fine. Of course, the closer you are, the easier it is to get a high spatial resolution. But I will come back later to the different relationship between the different properties you want to get in your image. And you will see there are a lot of constraints when you want to get a high spatial resolution or whatever. So basically, because of the altitude, because altitude decided 100% the time necessary for one orbit, so the time necessary for one cycle, a spot can observe any point of Earth within 26 days. So why? Because here is a trajectory spot follow during one day. So there is a small something here that is, which is a fraction. It means the next day, it will go to another part of the world, and the next day, another part of the world. So in 26 days, basically all the holes, all the distance between these different green light will be removed. The satellite will go all around all these places. So in 26 days, we can say that Spot will be able to observe any point of the Earth, especially if we consider that this property is that this sensor is able to change the viewing angle in 27 degree differences. So Spot satellites can observe any point of Earth, but every 26 days. If you want to observe the same point with a frequent observation, it's not possible. Formosat, on the contrary, don't have this further trajectory, so it will follow only the main green line, approximately. So it means this point, if this were, it's not, it is the orbit of Spot, but if the green light were showing the orbit of Formosat, it means this point, especially Taiwan, will be observable every day. But it means that this point is never observable. Why is it the case? Because Formosat has got a specific mission, is to observe the countries that bought it, Taiwan, every day. So the objective is to observe the national territory every day and not everywhere. So this is a first constraint. If you choose a satellite altitude, when the engineers choose a satellite altitude, it means they choose for which place can be observed. There is a second very strong constraint on this, is that modern optical sensors are designed to pass over each point always at the same hour. Spot, for example, passes over the observed point at in morning, always at 10:30. Why? This is because it allows to keep always the same azimuthal sun angle. The zenithal sun angle changes. For example, at 10:30 in morning in January, the sun is lower than at 10:30 in July. But the azimuthal sun angle remains the same. So it means we have less variation in how the sun and light irradiate the surface we want to study. So we need we always want to have sun-synchronous sensors. In order to have a sun-synchronous sensor, once you have chosen an altitude, you don't have a choice. You need to choose accordingly the good inclination. Inclination is the angle by which the plan of rotation of the satellite around the Earth is far from the line of from the pole to the other, which means here is a low inclination. If the satellite was here, it would be a high inclination. So when you for a satellite with a higher altitude, you will have a stronger inclination. So it means the satellite, instead of being here, would be here, and it will turn around the Earth like that. Which means what? It means that a satellite, which an optical satellite, optical sensor satellite, will not be able to observe the places in the north or in the south, simply because it doesn't pass over these places. So basically, all sensors are the product of a compromise because the altitude affects the revisit time and the longitudinal cover. So we have seen that when we were talking about the orbital cycle. It also constrains, it also affects directly the north to south covering capacity, because of the need to keep the sensor sun synchronous. Moreover, as you said, François, before, altitude affects the spatial resolution directly. The sensor, if the sensor is further away, the spatial resolution will be degraded. Also, the spectral resolution, the width of the spectral band, affects the radiometric resolution, which is the ability to distinguish different amount of energy. I told about that when I was talking about the panchromatic band. Panchromatic band is a band with a low spectral resolution, so the bandwidth is very large. So because the bandwidth is very large, it's possible to have a higher spatial resolution. Moreover, when you have a very fine spatial resolution, it means you observe small objects. So a small object mechanically means there is a small quantity of light that is reflected by this small object. A big object reflects more light. So also, and for the same reason as for the that explains why panchromatic allow higher spatial resolution, when you have when the sensor has got a small spatial, for the sensor that has got a very fine spatial resolution, so able to observe small objects, it would be difficult to have a good radiometric resolution. But this is not acceptable to have a bad radiometric resolution. Radiometric resolution, you can also call it, or it's a quantity that is closely related to the signal to noise ratio. So it means the signal you are interested will be totally, will be totally lost within the uncertainties. So you need a radiometric resolution. On the images here, you can see the same place observed with a low with a bad radiometric resolution, and here a good radiometric resolution. It means here you cannot do a lot of you cannot do precise interpretation. Here you can do more precise interpretation. So basically, if you have a high spatial resolution, it is difficult to keep a good radiometric resolution. What you can do is to, for example, degrade your spectral resolution. So all the different parameters, swaths, altitude, spectral resolution, spatial resolution are all linked together. So the consequence is that each sensor is a compromise depending on mission objective. And for example, Landsat is a very generalist mission. It has a 16-day frequency. So if you want to observe more often, it's not possible, but still 16 days is much better than what you can do with Iconos or GY, for example. It has got a full longitudinal coverage because of this 16-day frequency. It has got a 30 meter resolution. On the contrary, Formosat is specific. It can see only some points over Earth, but it can do it every day. So this is finished to introduce the differences between the different sensors. In the next lecture, we will talk about how to use these different images with different categories of methods. So I guess maybe you have some questions about what I have said until now today.
Go on.
I have a question. Could you please explain the link between, to explain albedo, so the link, I guess, between spectral radiance and albedo?
Albedo is a sort of integration of reflectance. So a spectral radiance is a measurement, it's a quantity of energy. Reflection is a fraction of energy that is reflected. Reflectance and albedo are in concept very close. But when we talk about albedo, we talk about how much energy is reflected by a surface in a very large part of the spectrum and together including all the directions. But with remote sensing, we cannot measure that. We cannot measure albedo, because the sensor is located somewhere from the surface. So here you can do a measure. If you know how much light comes from the sun and you measure the quantity of light that is reflected, you can measure the reflectance in this specific direction. If we wanted to have albedo, we would have to make the same measurement in all possible directions, make a sort of average or a sum, and integrate over a large range of wavelengths.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, and so Nicolas, I've seen once I think it's the TRMM satellite, which they basically changed the orbit and pushed it like further away from the Earth or closer to the Earth. I don't remember exactly. So does it have consequences on how long the satellite can remain in the space, and does it affect the quality of information that is collected?
It changes a lot of things. If the orbit, so TRMM is a passive microwave sensor, and okay. It is for precipitation. Mm-hmm. If the I don't know about why it has been adjusted. Anyway, if the altitude have changed to the lower altitude, this affects the life expectancy of the satellite. At lower altitude, the mission will not last for long. At higher altitude, I don't see any reason why it should affect the duration of the mission. But if when the altitude change, one parameter that will change is the spatial resolution. Because the antenna is further away, it will observe a bigger area, so the spatial resolution is degraded. Okay. It will change also the orbital cycle, so the time for revisiting. But because it is a passive microwave, there is no constraint due to the need of a sun synchronous, because it does not use the energy from the sun. So there is more freedom to do it.
I see.
But in the same order of ideas, spot 5 and spot 4 are not working anymore. And just before the year before they stopped, there was a decision to make some experiments that was to decrease the altitude. So by doing so, it was sure that the satellite will fall down after some while, which allowed to do something that was to change the time of revisit of certain point of the Earth to start the prospection of what can be done with what could be do with future. It was before 2014 with the future Sentinel-2 data. Because the altitude was smaller, the time of revisit of some points of the Earth was different. So it was 1 day or 2 days or 5 days. And that was used. There was some research proposals or calls to say, what do we do with such a frequent time series over this point? So by changing this, there was some experiment on prospection of the potential of Sentinel-2.
Yeah. I see. So are there other questions?
So we heard a lot of definitions, and so will be the slides available somewhere, at least what we have heard so far, or some definition?
Yeah, I can provide some.
Yeah. Yeah, then we'll try to post the slides, or Nicolas post the slides on his own website, and we'll put a link from the PSC webpage, like from the collaborative project webpage, or we post them on the collaborative project webpage, as Nicolas prefers.
Okay, yeah, I can put it on my website.
Okay, so I propose to close this session and wish you all the best, a good weekend. We're not yet there, but almost. And see you basically next week.
The week after.
The week after, yes, yeah, sorry. On May 18th.
Yeah. Yeah, so thanks to everyone for attending. So hope it was clear. Don't hesitate on the next time to ask questions about what I said today or the day or on Tuesday.